all three trips. And I have a little bit better judgment now of what feeling is, what form is going to suit the feeling that I have. Like, that feeling is really complicated. It's not going into three sentences or that kind of thing. But I do think that a good song, at the end of the day, is these three sentences. And I think for me, coming from a writing background and not a musical background, it took me a while to think about music in terms of how I could really use it as a language. Because again, I felt and I still feel that it is this very big mystery that it's bigger than something I can completely understand. But I do think that that's where you enter into what makes a song different from a story or a poem. And I always think about one of my favorite songs is You Make Me Feel Like a Natural Woman. And again, this is a really recent song. When my soul was in the lost and found, you came along to claim it. I didn't know what was wrong with me. Kiss, help me name it. You make me feel like a natural woman. I mean, it's very plain spoken language. It's not overly sophisticated. It's not trying too hard. It's the words that two people speak to each other on the street. And even if somebody just said that to you or wrote you that in a letter or a poem, that would be a very nice thing. But once you add music to it, that's when it really becomes something of power. When my soul was in the lost and found, you came along to claim it. I know just what was wrong with me. Stop missing the horns and strings. Your kiss helped me name. You make me see. You make me feel like a natural woman. Woman. So, you know, I mean, all that, that's nothing, you know, that's not even the chords. That's just a melody. And I think that it took me a while to realize that, you know, I was listening to my Dylan records or my Van Morrison records or my Joni Mitchell records, that, you know, there's this kind of air of flippancy, of just off, you know, the importance of being off the cuff in music, in rock and roll, maybe not in all music. Not with my friend Simone, but so there's this air of like, you know, of cool. Like, you know, I'm not really even going to lift my finger to explain to you how I feel. You know, I mean, Keith Richards is kind of like, yeah, I need a love to make me happy. And I think that when you, as much as we enjoy listening to that, when you go in to write a song, you can't. I mean, maybe that did just come to Keith Richards. Maybe all those songs did just roll off of Bob Dylan's tongue, but that isn't really happening to me that often. And so as much as you might strive for this very casual feel, there is a very formal language and structure that you have at your hands when you're writing a song, which nobody told me that. I didn't really study music. But even if I had, I don't think they would have told me what I'm explaining to you, which is how I think about all of this. I think about music as a language. I think about chord structures like the way that you would put a subject and a predicate together. And I think about when I'm writing a song, that, okay, well, I have this setting. I have all the things that I have when I wrote a short story. I have a setting, plot, character, your timeline, you know, all of those little details that, whether they make it into the formal three sentences or not, you've made those decisions and you've made sure that people feel that. But it goes even further, and all of a sudden you have these new tools at hand. You have rhythm, you have melody, which I think melody is a lot of plot on. You know, I mean, a beautiful melody rises and falls the way that the story in a classical, you know, classical storytelling does. And it may not be from, you know, the beginning song to the end, but it's an interesting arc that draws you in. And then again, you know, do you guys know any music theory at all? Or usually when I'm talking to people as writers and I start to talk about music theory, the tiny bit that I know and I'm like, ooh, but do you guys know any music theory at all? Yes. We know the 1-4-5 here? Yes. Yeah, no? Well, 1-4-5 is like, when I was learning to play music, my dad taught me how to play the guitar, and he taught me three chords. Actually, he taught me four chords. And he said, Tift, you don't need any other chord in the world. You play any song in the world with these three chords, and don't bother with all the ones up in that. They're no good. And he was right. Kind of. But what he taught me was the 1-4-5. And the 1, 4, and 5 are the three basic chords. It's probably a happy birthday. I should probably show you. This is for the people that don't know the 1-4-5. If we were to play in the people's key of G, that's G, that's the 1. This is the 4 chord. It's going to be music in terms of deliberate choices and a structure that I can function within. I can kind of sit down at my desk in the dark and say, okay, whatever big, huge, tremendous, scary feeling is going to come at me, I'm going to let it come with more freedom because I know that I'm equipped with a lot of choices and a lot of structures and a lot of nuance in my toolbox, rather than just sitting down going like, all right, the first thing that comes to me, I'm going to Keith Richards it and assume that it's rock and roll and where it's supposed to be. And I think you don't necessarily have to be somebody who is, I mean, obviously, I don't know, I know music by listening. And I think listening is to music as reading, as writing is to reading. And what I know about music, I know that Carole King song that I sent to you, I know that is soul music. I know the characteristics of it from listening to my records. I know that to me soul music is a really strong feeling delivered in a really strong way, with a really strong beat that definitely don't straighten it out and make it one. You know, you guys are taking this so seriously. You know, I know that if I'm writing a song that is very lyric driven, it's probably going to land a lot closer to a folk song than it is to a soul song. Because in soul music, the words are going to get in the way of the feeling. But soul music is really story driven stuff. It's plot driven. It's a murder ballad. It's I'm giving you information. Soul music is I'm giving you a feeling and you're going to feel it. And these are things that you just learn by listening to records and picking them out. You know, I know that if I have a really detailed story to tell you, I'm not going to tell it to you in the way that the Rolling Stones would. That would be a real waste of a 2 and a 4, you know. So I think as much as you can develop a system of thinking about song structures that works for you, where when your feeling comes, you say, what best serves this? I mean, it's all in service to that feeling in the end, but it's not none of it's meant to like box your feeling in or box your story in, but it's meant to help give it legs to stand on its own and walk away from you, which I think is what good songs do. You know, by the time they finish, they don't serve me anymore, I serve them. And so I just try to be a student of music and of language so that when something comes that is worth writing about, I can serve it well. And I think thinking about these things in specific ways and having choices at hand rather than just being this overwhelming, what do I do, is the strongest way that I have learned to be of service to what I'm trying to do. And, you know, at the end of the day, this is something that isn't in this talk here, because I don't think I knew this when I was, right, I wrote this talk a couple of years ago. At the end of the day, when I don't know the answer, I think it's really important not to say, okay, I'm just going to decide that this is a folk song and I'm going to impart and just impale the song with that structure. You know, I think at the end of the day, it always goes back to listening. And I go back, I don't really know the answer. I don't really know what the lyric is. I don't really know what the melody is yet. I don't really know what the groove is yet. I don't really know what I'm doing. I go back to that first fragment, to that first moment, and I listen. And I listen really hard. And usually, the answer is in that. So, I guess at the end of the day, it's all really about it's always a real challenge, I think, to not force things, but to make a clear decision. You know, that's always a really, sometimes I go back and I go, what? I just totally made that song something that it wasn't. I'm such a dumbass. And I think the same thing is definitely true at that moment where, you know, I think I was talking about the three sentences and then I was talking about the music, and I think it's really important to me that the language and the musical decisions, there's a moment where the song is kind of just the ideas born, and then you start making these decisions, and I usually make the musical decisions and I come up with a verse and a chorus. And then I said, okay, now I've got this melody and this fragment of a lyric, but now I have some chords and a melody and a rhythm, and I'll finish the lyrics. And if at any point they're fighting each other, or I'm stuck on the music and I'm forcing a decision, or I'm making, if that marriage doesn't feel like it wants to happen, I usually stop and go. And I think that what is really interesting about songwriting is the time that the language and the music come together and they feel like they were meant for each other. And you cannot, I can't ever force that. Probably, I mean, Dylan is really good at forcing the language into the music, but he lets some of the music go. You know, he's not making, I mean, he's doing everything perfectly, but don't get me wrong. But, you know, when you listen to a Dylan song, you're not like, wow, this is going to be as catchy a melody as Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And I'm going to sing it. You know, it's about the message, it's about the words. And he made that decision on purpose. And I, in any list, look at somebody like Joni Mitchell, and she's not making that decision. She's not letting the music, she's making sure that the chords that she's choosing are as unresolved and as puzzling as the words that she's saying. And for me, I just want to make sure that those words and those and the chords and the melody feel like they were born in the same moment, and that they're meant together, and if they're fighting with each other, we should just call it. And then at the end, once I get that done, now the verse and the chorus, I back to the bridge. I think that the bridge is really the entree of your song. And I always, when I'm writing a bridge, I look at what I've said so far in the first chord, in the first verse and the chorus and the second verse and the chorus. And I think, what the hell was I trying to say? And I sat down to write the song. What was it that I had to say? And you think that, for me, I was thinking, why do I have to ask myself that? That's such a stupid question, but it's the most important question. What was I trying to say? And I make sure that I say it as directly as possible when I write a bridge. And then the third verse, you know, takes the next step from there. And you don't really know what that's going to be because it took you all of that time to figure out what you were really trying to say once you actually said it. You know, it's like breakthrough. How in the world is going to look after that? And that's what the third verse is. And I've rambled some. I believe very much in traditional song structures and in how they help me and protect me and build things that didn't exist before when I am trying to stare things that don't have a structure down and give them structure. So, again, don't forget that meter and melody and chord structure and pace and all of those choices at hand are just like choosing strong words. They're just like choosing a character or a setting or a plot, or are you going to write a sonnet or a sestina? I mean, these are, you know, those are all things that we were taught in our basic grammar classes, and I just come at music as someone from that world, so I think about those voices the same way that I read elements of a story. They're just, that's the magic of working in music, is that you have this palette that you don't have when you're just writing those.